next one here, still on the positive school of thought in criminology, we have here, it says it leads to the use of psychology in studying offenders also. So, katulad niya ng sinabi ko kanina, they focus more on criminal behaviors and behaviors that is actually under or it is being studied by psychology, diba? Okay, so opening the way for different kinds of sentences and treatments that fit the criminal and not the crime. Okay, so na-consider na dito yung mental conditioning or nung mindset, okay, whether that person is insane or whether that person is sane, okay, or normal in thinking, okay. So that is also being considered by the positivist school, okay. And we have here the famous personalities under positivist school of thought in criminology. Number one in here, Cesar Lombroso, okay, the famous one. So it starts from, if you're going to take a look, talagang mas nauna yung dates, okay, or nauna sila Cesar Beccaria. So as to Cesar Lombroso, it starts from 1835 until 1909. So he's actually an Italian physician and psychiatrist. In some books, they say also that he's a criminologist. Okay, and it says here he moved away from the nature of the crime towards the criminal motivations and habits, as I've mentioned a while ago. Instead of the criminal conduct or the crime itself, to study what is murder, to study what did he do, okay, or to study what did he steal, okay, anong pera ang kinuha, I mean, magkanong pera ang kinuha, mga ganun. Pero ang sinasagot na question niya is more on the reasons or the motivations and habit. Why that certain person did crime or why did he commit the crime? So, naging ganun yung focus naman ni Cesar Lombroso. So, with that, it lays the foundations for modern criminology. So, as of now, di ba tayo, we are also not analyzing or we are not learning just what is a crime. I mean, what are those crimes? What is murder? What are the elements of murder? What are the elements of homicide? What is the penalty of homicide? Hindi lang natin ini-study yun, di ba? In criminology, we are also studying the reason behind. Ano kaya ang dahilan? Okay, ano yung motivation ng taong yun? Why did he commit the crime? Okay, so that is why we considered also Cesar Lombroso is the father of modern criminology. Okay, another one here, Cesar Lombroso believed that there was a criminal class that was not as evolved as the rest of society. Okay, meron bang ganun talaga? Na yung itsura is katulad nung itsura ng mga sinaunang tao or hindi nag-evolve. Kasi Cesar Lombroso is actually a fan of Charles Darwin or the evolution theory of Charles Darwin. Okay, kaya naging ganito rin yung idea niya or yung belief niya. Okay? That yung mga taong yon na hindi nag-evolve, okay, hindi nag-successfully nag-evolve as the rest of the society or mga katulad ng pagmumukha natin, okay? So, kanila parang pagmumukha pa ng mga ancient, mga Homo sapiens, mga Homo erectus, mga ganon. Okay, or mga nagmumukhang ape pa, sinabi niya those are classified or those are considered as criminal class. Okay, so anong tawag niya doon? Sinabi niya as atavism, pure they possess atavistic characteristics. Okay, and then yan ay pinresent niya sa libro niya, which he published in 1876, that is The Criminal Man. So, in-study niya yung isang criminal dito, and then nagbigay siya dito sa kanyang libro, okay? Binigay niya yung mga findings niya, yung opinion niya about crimes, okay? And he argued that some people, ito yung atavistic characteristics, yung sinasabi niya, were born criminals. Diyan na din present, and then sinabi niya, those born criminals have an atavistic characteristics, or throwbacks of primitive stage of evolution, or yung mga nagmumukhang unggoy or ape pa. So, sinabi niya, yun yung usual na facial characteristics or physical characteristics of a person who has a greater tendency to commit crime. Okay, but I don't know if you agree with that, but maybe most of you will say no. Okay, it is not that true. Okay, so anyway, that is the atavism or atavistic characteristics that was mentioned. Take note of that. Okay, kasi tinatanong to, atavistic or atavism. take note of that. Take note of the meaning. This is the meaning actually. Okay? Or eto, sinabi dyan, throwbacks of the primitive stage of evolution. Okay? And then we have here, the classification of criminals according to Cesar Lombroso. We have here the born criminals. Okay? Born criminals says, I believe on that. Okay? Na meron talagang pinanganak na criminal because naniniwala siya, criminal behaviors, it is being inherited from the parents to the offsprings. Another one here, he classified as criminal by passion. So ito naman, these are the persons or individuals who were influenced by their great emotions. Okay, katulad na lang ng anger, extreme anger. Okay, kaya nagawa ng krimen dahil sa sobrang galit niya, na-blackout siya, nagawa niyang patayin yung kapitbahay niya. Ganon. Okay, that is considered as criminal or he is considered as a criminal by passion. Okay, another one is insane criminals. By the word insane, syempre, ito naman yung mga may problema sa pag-iisip. Okay, but not all the time. Okay, so itong insane criminals, not all the time they are excused, okay, of being penalized. Okay, kasi sa batas natin, meron yung instances, especially here in the Philippines. Meron yung instances na insane criminals, they are mitigated or they are exempted from punishment. Pero not all the time. Kasi meron daw yung times they believe. Okay, or psychologists, maybe those persons who are experts in studying about insane people, they say that there are times na yung baliw, meron silang araw or merong oras na sila ay nasa normal na pag-iisip or matino sila. Okay, pero meron yung times sila ay baliw. Mga ganun, meron yung times normal sila. So yun yung dinidetermine ng ating court. Okay, if during the commission of the crime, he is insane, then he may be exempted from the punishment. Pero kapag na-find out ng korte during the process of investigation, na-find out na siya ay normal, okay, he was sane. Sane meaning normal. Normal yung mental processing or yung pag-iisip na during that time, then he will not be exempted from punishment. So, mapaparusahan siya. Okay, so that is just an additional with regards to insane criminals. So anyway, that is also a classification by Cesar Lombroso. Another one here is the criminaloid. So he, as to the books, okay, so napakarami actually conflicting definitions about criminaloid. But anyway, this is what I find out also about, especially in our source, okay, about the definition or how did Cesar Lombroso define criminaloid, okay? So, some sources, siguro iba yung makikita nyo, but as to what we have here, it says, para hindi tayo magkalituhan, maybe you will try to research more also about it, okay? And then let's try to, you can raise that, maybe in our comment section, or maybe you can try to raise it in our synchronous session, and let's try to discuss about it. Okay, and as to what we have here, it says, criminaloid, these are people or persons who practice impersonification of good. Okay, a person who projects himself as a respectable, upright in the society concealing his criminal personality. So, this is basically yung mga tao, sabi natin, mga politicians na kurako. Okay, so pinoproject nila na sila ay napakagandang tao, I mean napakabuting tao. Pero on the other hand, sila naman pala ay criminal, gumagawa ng kalokohan, mga corrupt na tao. Okay, so they are classified as criminaloid. Sabihin natin, meron din yung iba, okay, na tao na nagpro-project sila, na tumutulong sa mga charity. Okay, nagbibigay sila ng mga pera, pero at on the other hand, sila naman para ay drug lords. Okay, so they are classified as criminaloid. Okay, according to the source that we have. Okay, so we have here also number 5, occasional criminal by the word occasional. So ito yung nabigyan ng opportunity. Okay, so these are the people or person who committed a crime due to an insignificant reasons that pushed them to do at a given occasion. Okay, occasional criminal. So another one in here, pseudo-criminals. Pseudo-criminals, those who kill in self-defense. Nakagawa sila ng krimen dahil pinagtanggol lang nila yung sarili nila. So don't forget that is the 6th classification of criminals of Cesar Lombroso. Pseudo-criminals yung pang-anim. Okay, and then we have here Enrico Ferry naman. So, na-mention ko na siya kanina. So, he was the student of Cesar Lombroso. So, kung si Cesar Lombroso, nag-focus siya on biological determinism. Pero si Enrico Ferri, he focused more on individual's environmental or environment. Okay, sabi niya, environmental or environment plays a role in whether or not they commit a crime. So, nag-focus siya more on environment. Pero hindi naman yet, medyo re-reject niya. Okay, yung biological determinism ni Cesar Lombroso na pwede nating ma-identify yung tao or yung criminal basing sa pagmumukha or pag-iitsura. So, hindi ako naniniwala sa'yo, teacher, sabi niya. So, yun, sinabi niya, pinagtunan niya muna more ng pansin yung environment. Okay, and which is maybe most of you will agree with Enrico Ferri. Okay? So, yun yung contribution naman ni Enrico Ferri. And Rafael Garofalo naman, another student of Cesar Lombroso. So he was known as a magistrate in Italian court system and also a senator and minister of justice. So he rejected also the classical view, okay, of free will, okay, saying that criminals were slaves to impulses out of their control. Okay, free will, saying that criminals, he says, rejects the classical views of free will. Kasi sabi ni, anong sabi nila doon sa classical school about free will? They said that people, or all people have the free will or have the capability to choose between right or wrong. Okay? Pero ang sabi niya, no? Ni Rafael Garofalo, no. Okay? Free will are being influenced, okay, by the impulses out of their control. Okay? So, paano yun? So, with that, meron kasi yung, di ba, napilitan ka lang gawin dahil sa kailangan. Okay? Matinding pangangailangan. Sabihin natin, sobrang gutom na gutom ka na. Okay? And yun nga, wala kang kapera-pera. Alam mo na masamang magnakaw. Pero yun nga, gutom na gutom ka na. Okay, so anong pipiliin mo? Mamatay sa gutom? Or gumawa ng kalokohan para lang makakain? So with that, what we are pointing out is, yes, we all have free will, but yun nga lang, as to Rafael Garofalo, people or criminals are slaves to impulses out of their control. Katulad na lang ng hunger, okay, or basic needs. So that is just only one situation that we can give there. Another one, it says here, crime is not a violation of a law, but as a violation of nature. Okay, a violation of the law of God. Then, sabi ni Rafael Garofalo. Okay? An act was a crime if it violated human nature is either way of two forms, probity and piety, pity or piety. So, commonly they use piety. Okay? But anyway, when we say piety, it talks about probity, it talks about the honesty and integrity, and piety or it talks about the compassion to others, and piety, devotion to religious duties and practices. Okay, so, na-define din or lumabas dito according to Rafael Garofalo, siya din yung nagpasimula, with the Malaense. Okay, the belief the classification of crimes wherein it is evil in themselves, or it is evil in nature. Okay, it's very wrong in its nature, yung Malaense. If you remember on your introduction, meron tayong mala prohibita and mala inse. Okay, so mala prohibita, these are actions that became wrong, or it is not good because it is prohibited by mankind laws. Okay, law of humans. Pero pag mala inse, yan naman yung sinasabi natin na actions. It is wrong because it is prohibited by the law of God. Okay? Or it is very wrong in nature. So, mala prohibita, anong example niyan? So, paggamit ng droga. Okay, paggamit ng droga, is it very wrong in nature? Okay? Is it very wrong in its nature? Meron ba sa batas ng Diyos, huwag kang gumamit ng droga or in others? Pero, kasi sa ibang study, sinabi naman nila, drugs are actually, or illegal, some of the illegal drugs, it can cure illnesses. Yun nga lang, it is being abused, kaya siguro nagiging ganon. Nagiging masama yung epekto. But with that, is the use of drugs very wrong? It is in its nature. Actually, it's not. Okay? So it is not actually very known its nature. Nagiging mali lang yan kasi yan ay pinoprohibit ng batas ng tao. Okay? Pinagbabawal natin. Diba? Sa ibang bansa, okay ang paggamit ng drugs. Sa ating bansa, okay, bawal ang paggamit ng drugs. Okay? So it is very wrong. It is not very wrong from its nature, but it is wrong because of it is being punishable or it is prohibited by a certain law. Okay, and Malaense, just to classify it, sa Malaense naman, it is very wrong in its nature. So, kahit wala pa mang batas na mag-prohibit niyan, maling-mali yan sa mata ng tao. Okay, katulad na lang ng killing, okay, or murder. Okay, killing a person, it's very wrong it's in nature, diba? Stealing, it's very wrong it's in its nature. Kahit pa sa batas ng Diyos, it is very wrong, diba? Stealing, sabi yan. Okay, and others, adultery, mga yun. Okay, so those are classified as malaense. And then take note of these meanings, terminologies that was used in here. So it says here, violation, crimes is in violation of probity, or in honesty or integrity, or it could be on the, say, the law of man. Okay, and then we have here, piety, devotion to religious, or yung law of nature. Okay, so with that, or malaense, fall ang malaense sa piety, crimes against piety. Okay, and we have here classifications of criminal naman according to Rafael Garofalo. So number one in here, we have murderers. So those who are satisfied from vengeance or revenge. Okay, so yan naman yung pagkaka-define niya as to what is murderers. Okay, and violent criminals, those who commit very serious crimes. Okay, but they are not, pero kapag yan ay serious crime and it involves revenge or killing a person, and involves vengeance or revenge, then that is classified as murderous. But if it is not, okay, just like na lang, maybe bombing, okay, destruction of a property, okay, that could be a serious crime, okay, so that could be a violent crime, or they could be classified as violent criminals, okay, by Rafael Garofalo. And we have here deficient criminals, those who commit crime against property, okay, so robbery, ganon, theft, and others. We have here lascivious criminals, those who commit crime against justice. Katulad na lang ng of lasciviousness, panghihipo ng mga wet or private property ng isang tao or other person. Okay? That is a lascivious conduct. Okay? Or crimes against justice. Adultery, ganon, bigamy, and then nandyan din concubinage, and others. Okay, makikipagtalik sa hindi mo asawa, and others. Another one here, that's good in positivist school of thought in criminology. It's time for us to proceed with neoclassical theory. So, napapiyawan na natin to kanina din. Okay, with regards dun sa discussion natin, classical. So, kung mapapansin ninyo, neo means new. Okay, so this is actually a new classical theory. So there is no, in different sources that we tried to look at, wala tayong nakitang authors nito or proponents. But anyway, it is a theory school that opposes the ideas, okay, of the classical school of criminology. Not totally to oppose lahat ng ideas ng school na yon, but to propose change, okay, or revision of some of those proponents or proposed ideas of the classical school. So we have here a question. So would a society want to punish a 12-year-old first-time shoplifter the same way as a 33-year-old, okay, it should be year, not er, okay, year-old previous offender who shoplifted the same item? So, kung sa tingin ninyo, nararapat lang ba na yung ipapataw nating parusa doon sa 35 years old na nagnakaw, okay lang ba na ipataw din natin yan sa 12 years old? Is it just? Is it the same? So, maybe some of you will say yes. Maybe some of you will say no. Okay? But maybe most of you will say it is not. Ba? Hindi yan fair. Kasi ang 35 years old, mature na yan. May pag-iisip na yan. Okay? or he have the capability to choose between right or wrong. Okay, mature na yung pag-iisip niya in choosing or in decision making. While at 12 years old, do you think he has enough maturity to decide for his own? So maybe not. Okay? So yan yung tanong ng neoclassical theory. Tanong na pwedeng maitanong ng neoclassical theory. And another one, does a society want to punish a mentally challenged? May problema sa pag-iisip. One-time car thief to the same extent as it would a normally functioning person who has been convicted of stealing more than a dozen cars. Okay, or yung taong mga carnappers talaga. Dapat lang ba na parehas yung, sabihin natin, first-time offender na may problema sa pag-iisip ng carnap? Parehas, do you think it is just na parehas lang yung impose na penalty sa kanya? Okay, will that person na paulit-ulit na gumawa ng carnapping? Okay, nagko-commit ng carnapping paulit-ulit. Okay lang ba na parehas sila ng impose na penalty? Decide. Okay, person with the mental problem. Okay, maybe some of you will say yes, maybe some of you will say no, but maybe most of you will say no. It is not just. Okay? So, yan yung tanong ng neoclassical theory. So, with that, meron silang pinopose na changes or revisions with the ideas of those classical school. So, number one dyan, sinabi nila, classicism concentrated on the criminal act, okay, or criminal conduct, and ignored individual differences between criminals, which is true. Diba? So, sinabi nila, lahat ng tao may free will. Meron silang kakayahan na mamili kung ano yung tama at mali, sabi nila. Kaya dapat nararapat lang silang parusahan. Yun yung sabi ng classical school. Pero sabi ng neoclassical school, yes, maybe. Okay, or sinabi nila, hindi lahat ng tao merong free will. Bakit? Okay, paano na lang yung mga baliw? Okay, yung insane people, meron ba silang kakayahan na mamili ng tama dun sa mali? Eh, baliw nga sila, may problema sila sa pag-iisip. Paano naman yung mga bata? Okay, 7 years old, katulad ng 6 years old, meron ba silang free will or kakayahan, capability to choose between right or wrong? Okay, so, yun yung mga tanong ng classical school. Okay, I mean, classical theory. So, yun yung kine-question nila sa neoclassical school of criminology. So, with that, ano din, neoclassicism still held that free will is important, but that it can be constrained by physical and environmental factors. So even though pati sa atin, yes, tayong matatanda, we have actually free will. Almost most of us, normal person in the right age has free will. Okay? Capability to choose between right and wrong. Yun nga lang, it is constrained by physical and environmental factors. Katulad na lang ni sinabi ni Rafael Garofalo. Okay? Impulses. Okay? Yung needs natin. Nagnakaw ka kasi gutom na gutom ka. Alam mo na mali ang magnakaw pero wala kang ibang pagkunan, no? Let's say hindi ka matanggap sa trabaho, wala kang mapagkunan ng pera para pambili ng pagkain. Kahit sabihin mo masamang magnakaw, pero yun nga, hindi ka naman tinatanggap sa trabaho kasi wala kang pinag-aralan. Saan ka kukuha ng pera mo? Kahit sa kalsada mamalimos ka, hindi ka naman binibigyan ng mga tao. So wala kang ibang choice or talagang maiisip mong magnakaw with that kind of situation, di ba? So even though you know that it is very wrong, but you need to do it because excuse me, kinakailangan mo. Okay? And aside from that, sabihin natin, ikaw ay pinilit na gawin yung isang bagay. Sabihin natin, tinutukan ka ng baril sa ulo mo. Okay, and then sabi sa'yo, patayin mo si ganito or ikaw ang papatayin ko. So anong gagawin mo? Even though you have a free will to choose na yun, kapag pinatay mo siya, maling-mali yung ginawa mo. Pero yun, kapag hindi mo ginawa yun, kapalit naman yan buhay mo. Okay, that is a physical factor, a constraining factor, di ba? So with that, may punto talaga ang neoclassical theory with that. Okay, and another one, These are the revisions that they introduced. So, allowing for mitigating circumstance. So, sa batas na natin, meron na yung tinatawag nating jumaa. Okay? Jumaa. Jumaa circumstances. Kapag makuha niyo yung criminal law book 1 ninyo or maybe sa CGS ninyo na encounter niyo yung jumaa na to. So, jumaa stands for ito, justifying. Okay? And then mitigating circumstances. Another one in here is aggravating or pataasin yung penalty. And then we have here alternative. So, pwede niyang pataasin yung penalty or pababahan yung penalty. Depende sa status ng isang tao. For mitigating, ito yung na-emphasize ng new classical theory. Sa justifying pala, yan ay yung mga tao na justified. So, parang wala silang nagawang krimen. Kasi justified sila. Or in a way na nakagawa lang sila ng krimen dahil sa sila ay nag-self-defense. Or it's because of self-defense. Okay? Pero dito sa mitigating factor, okay, mitigating circumstance, sinabi dyan, babaan yung kaso. Sabi dyan, by looking at the situation, okay, physical and social environment in which individual had been placed. So, sabihin natin yung pinilit na pumatay ng ibang tao dahil lamang sa siya ay tinutukan ng baril kapalit ng buhay niya. Okay, so that could be subject for mitigating circumstances. Sabihin natin yung baliw nag-commit ng crime. Maybe, pwede yang mabigyan ng mitigating circumstances. Meron din pala dito yung exempting, jumaa. Okay, so exempting circumstances, it stands for, exempting. Okay, may exempt siya sa punishment. So with that, yun yung titignan, yung situation, yung buong situation, buong nangyari, hindi lang yung krimen yung titignan. Mayroong nangyaring pagpatay or murder. So hindi ibig sabihin nun na impose mo yung penalty lahat-lahat sa kanya. Kasi nagawa lang naman niyang patayin kasi pinilit siya. Okay, so that should be considered, sabi ng neoclassical theory. Dapat yan ay i-consider yung situation kasi unfair yan sa tao, di ba? Unfair dun sa tao na nakapatay dahil lang sa pinilit siyang patayin yung ibang tao na yun. Okay, so that is one of the revision or proposed revision of the new classical. It says here also, some allowance was given for an offender's past record. Okay, a court needs to take into account an offender's criminal history and life circumstances when making decision about someone's sentence. So, nandito na yung recidivism. Sinasabi nila, you are going to encounter this in your criminal law subject. Recidivism. So, recidivism, sinasabi naman nila dyan, yung paulit-ulit na gumagawa ng krimen. Okay? Or mga habitual. Okay? In other words, habitual criminal. Okay? Habitual criminal, paulit-ulit na gumagawa ng krimen. So, with that, sabi ng New Classical School, dapat i-consider yan ng court in giving penalties dun sa mga tao yun. So, pwedeng yan ay maging dahilan para i-aggravate. Okay? Aggravating circumstance or i-aggravate or taasan yung penalty na ibibigay. Okay? Kasi ngayon, habitual criminal, paulit-ulit siya. So, nararapat lang na bigyan siya ng mas mataas na penalty than just the normal penalty na i-impose dapat. Okay? So, that is under number 2. Number 3, consideration should be given for factors like incompetence, pathology, insanity, and impulsive behavior. Tingnan din nila yung pag-iisip. Insane ba yung taong yan? May problema ba sa personality yan? May problema ba sa emotion yan? Okay? Or in others, immature ba yan? There's also certain individuals such as children. As I mentioned a while ago, yung 12 years old na situation na yan between the 35 years old. So, okay lang ba na pareha sila ng penalty? Or meron ba silang free will? Okay? And then those person who are mentally ill, okay, and less capable of exercising their reason. So, those should be considered, sabi ng new classical theory. Okay, so those are some of the proposed revisions under new classical theory. And now, we are going to proceed with deterrence theory naman. So, under deterrence theory, as I've mentioned a while ago, nung dinidiscuss natin si Cesar Beccaria and Jeremy Bentham, kasi popular sila dito. Okay, and then people, it says here, people are motivated to obtain pleasure and avoid pain. So, with that, we should counterbalance this pleasure or the ways on how people achieve or obtain pleasure. Okay, So, para hindi palaging merong krimen na mangyayari. So, let's try to know more about it. So, it says here, crime then can be deterred by increasing the certainty. Okay? Certainty or likelihood of that person to get caught. Okay? Or to surely be penalized kapag ginawa niya yung krimen. Celerity, swiftness, gaano kabilis yung sinabi natin kanina. So, these are just the, it pertains to the basic the elements of a punishment that serves deterrent factors. So, celerity, swiftness, so dapat just the time or just after the commission of the crime or just after the arresting of the person, meron na dapat trial na, may undergo ng trial and then may bigyan na talaga ng judgment agad-agad. Okay, and then severity or the kaano kabigat. Key of legal punishment for committing it. Okay, so dapat increase, it should be increased. Okay, it should outweigh the pain should outweigh the pleasure. Okay, so if we want to deter crime, ganun dapat yun, yung classification niya. Characteristics niya. So, with that, we have here the classification of deterrence. So, number one is specific deterrence. So, it pertains or it is a method of punishment in the criminal justice system intended to discourage criminal behavior in the specific individual. Okay? So, take note of the keyword here. The target is the specific individual or yung tao mismo. Okay? Para siya ay magtanda and hindi niya uulitin yung ginawa niya. Okay, paparusahan natin siya para siya ay magtanda and then hindi niya uulitin yung ginawa niyang krimen. So, that is a kind or example of, or that is what we so-called as specific deterrence. Paano naman kapag sinabing general deterrence? So, ang target naman dito is yung public at large. General deterrence, hindi yung tao. Okay, hindi natin paparusahan yung tao para siya ay magtanda and huwag niyang ulitin yung krimen na ginawa niya. Pero ang purpose ng pagpunish naman or yung tinatawag natin na general deterrence, ang purpose dito is for the public or yung nakakakita dun sa ginawa natin dun sa criminal is huwag nilang gayahin. Okay? Hindi nila gagawin yung ginawa nung taong yun na nag-commit ng crime. Okay? Or hindi din nila sila magko-commit ng crime. So, yun yung general deterrence. So, that is the difference between two. So, next one, we have here the so-called absolute deterrence naman. So, pag sinabing absolute deterrence naman, it refers to the fact that existence of punishment, says here, does deter an unknown amount of crime and wrongdoing. So, it's either on the part of the public or it's either on the part of the person, okay, or the specific person who committed the crime, okay, not to do or not to recommit the crime that he did. Again, okay? So, that is absolute deterrence. That's why it is absolute. It deters, okay? Large or any crimes or any wrongdoings. Here, it is absolute. And then, we have here restrictive deterrence. It says here, process whereby offenders limit the frequency, magnitude, or seriousness of their offense to avoid pain. So, especially in our drug law. Kasi, di ba, meron yung pagkakaiba-iba sabi ng penalty. Sabihin natin with regards to the user. So, mas meron yung user, meron yung, sabihin natin, drug pusher or distributor mismo. And then, meron yung creator or manufacturer or let's say the drug maker. Meron yung mga supplier. So, with that, merong different penalty na i-impose doon. So, meron yung penalty for pusher, mas mababa. User. Kasi user lang siya, mas mababa yung penalty. Pero yung pusher or yung nagbebenta, mas mataas yung penalty. And then, pinakamataas yung supplier mismo. Mga ganon. Okay, so with that, it causes actually to deter. Maybe yung isa, yung tao, he will not be pursuing in having or being a drug pusher kasi alam niya mataas yung penalty niya. Okay, so he will be just be a user. Okay, or the other one, Okay, he knows that being a supplier is greater or has a greater penalty than at least with that it can deter him to be part of the supplier. Or maybe in the case na sasabihin nila, hey, drug pusher ka ba? Hey, user lang po ako. Maamin sila pero yun niya, aaminin nila yung alam nila na mas mababa yung krimen. That is same also in restrictive deterrence. Okay, it deters. I mean, it limits the frequency or magnitude or seriousness of the offense to avoid pain. So, mas bababaan yung gagawin nila. Okay, mas bababaan yung gagawin. So, let's say, instead na ipakita na murder, okay, murder yung nangyaring krimen, ang gagawin is papakita na parang homicide kasi yun nga, lesser pain yung makukuha or lesser penalty yung naka-impose dun sa kind of crime yun or homicide. And then we have here the next one. Okay, what is the difference between actual punishment versus perceived punishment? So for the actual, by the word actual, it means the penalty is specified on the statute. Okay, yung nandun talaga sa statute. Okay, or dun sa batas. Okay, or dun sa code, or dun sa law. Na naka-specify, nasabihin natin, crime of murder, it is punishable by life imprisonment. So yun yung actual penalty, life imprisonment. For perceived punishment refers to the perceived certainty of arrest or severity of punishment by the person. So ito yung dito ito yung nasa side mismo or perception nung criminal. Okay, yung would be criminal. Okay, yung certainty of arrest. So sa tingin ba niya or yung ramdam niya kung sigurado meron bang kasiguraduhan na siya ay maaaresto or meron bang higher tendency na siya ay maaarest. Okay, or mas yung penalty ba na makukuha niya, is it severe? Okay? Is it grabe ba? Parang ganun. So, that is on the perceived punishment. It is the perception on the side of the would-be criminal. Pero yung actual, yun yung nandun mismo sa batas. Okay? And then we have here, right realism or rational choice theory or with the acronym RCT. Okay? And then we have here, it was popularly known in the 18th century with the work of Cesar Beccaria, rational choice theory. As I think na-mention ko na din ito nung dinidiscuss natin si Cesar Beccaria kanina. So sabi dyan, adapts a utilitarian belief that humans are reasoning actors who weigh means and ends, cost and benefits in order to make rational choice. So as I've used as an example kanina, ba, nandyan kasi yung utilitarianism. So people avoid, what is good for the greatest, then that should be followed. Okay, and then with that, kinakalculate na a human, it is believed under rational choice theory that a human calculates or weighs cost and benefit. So, or yung mapapala dun sa magiging consequence. So, kunwari, mas mataas yung pleasure, sabi natin kanina, kaysa dun sa pain, then tendency itutuloy na yung gawin or pipiliin niyang ituloy yung gawin. Kasi mas mataas yung pleasure. Pero kapag mas mataas yung penalty or pain, then tendency hindi niya tutuloy yung gagawin niya. So that is what we mean by that is the belief under rational choice theory. So under utilitarianism, so it says here, morally best action is the one that makes the most overall happiness or utility or usefulness, as I've mentioned a while ago. Okay, napag-usapan na natin kanina to. So, an action is justifiable if it brings the most amount of happiness for the greatest number of people. So, sa tingin ng nakakarami, is okay lang to, then maybe it could be given into consideration na, yes, he should be justified. Parang ganun. Especially in cases of self-defense. So, popular dito on utilitarianism si Jeremy Bentham. Pero as to the sources or different sources, it was also developed or it is added, okay, by some of famous personalities kagaya ni Francis Hutcheson and then John Stuart Mill. Pero pinaka-popular talaga under utilitarianism si Jeremy Bentham. And the next one we have here, the routine activity theory. So it is also popular proposed by Marcus Felson and Lawrence E. Cohen. Okay, it says here, a subfield of crime opportunity theory that focuses on situations of crime. Okay, so dito meron na tayo yung tinatawag na rat triangle. So ang sabi dito, reason for the increase in that increase is that the propensity of contemporary society offers more opportunities for crime to occur. So as I've mentioned a while ago, asan na yung rat triangle natin? Okay, so we have here the rat triangle or routine activity theory. So it is, we have here different din ito sa crime triangle theory. So napakaraming theory that are related to crime triangle. So anyway, ito yung rat triangle naman. So it was proposed by Cohen and Felson in 1979. So there are three elements wherein nandyan yung suitable target. That is, the second one is a motivated offender. Okay, it's in a crime perspective actually. And we have here the third, the lack of capable guardians. Okay, so with that, kapag wala yung isa dito, then merong mag-i-exist na krimen according to rat routine activity theory. So for example, sabihin natin yung sabihin natin in a case of maybe kidnapping. Okay? Sabihin natin meron diyan mag-ina. So an adult person, okay, yung nanay, and then yung kid, sabihin natin at 7 years old kid. So with that, sa tingin nyo ba, kung kasama yung nanay niya, okay, and then nasa public sila, sa tingin nyo, there is a high tendency na makidnap yung bata. Okay, maybe yes, there could be a chance na makidnap pa rin, even though, especially kapag yan ay mga criminal or professional criminal yung mga yan. Pero in a way na sabihin natin in a normal situation, so maybe there is a lesser chance na makidnap yung bata. Pero kapag sabihin natin na wala si capable guardian. Okay? Sorry. Mawala si capable guardian or yung nanay. So, yung 6 years old kid. So, tendency, there's a higher chance na siya ay maging victim of kidnapping. Okay? Kasi meron dyan. Suitable target. Okay? Motivated offender. Wala yung nanay or lack of capable guardian, then pwedeng makidnap yung bata. So, that is being presented by routine activity theory. So, it talks about opportunities. So, meron din silang nabigay na example dito, which is, ito, anong sabi? For example, the use of automobile on one hand, okay, enables offenders to move more freely to conduct their violations. And on the other hand, provide more targets for theft. Okay, so that is the example that they have here. So, on one hand, enables offenders to move. Okay, so marami silang magagawa. So it talks about the evolvement of technologies also. So the more na mas nag-evolve yung technology natin, crime also evolves or methodologies of criminals also evolves. Tulad ng paggamit na ng noon, walang magagamit na automobile or sasakyan para mag-commit ng crime. But as of now, meron na silang chance na makapag-commit ng crimes or makapag-commit ng makagawa, maging successful more sila in committing crimes with the use of automobile. Okay? So, that is just an example. Okay? So, and on the other hand, it provides more targets. So, meron tayong mananakaw na mga sasakyan. Okay? There is an opportunity or there is a given suitable target. Diba? Pwede. Kaya lumalabas na ang carnapping ngayon. So, that is just an example that was given in here. So, take note, the motivated offender, we refer to the person who is capable of committing the crime. And, the suitable target. So, merong four attributes. So, pinangalanan nilang Viva. Okay, or with the mnemonics Viva in here. So, V stands for value. So, it is calculated from the subjective rational perspective of an offender. Rational. Okay, normal thinking of the perspective, of the person. And then the other one here, the I, it stands for inertia. It refers to the physical aspects of a person or property that impedes or disrupts the suitability of a target. So, ito yung, status ng tao. Okay? Sabihin natin yung bahay, okay, na nakaprotekta sa kanya. Okay? Or yung mga gamit niya na nagpoprotekta sa kanya. Okay, or yung mga nakapaligid sa kanya. Okay, or it could be the person who protects him. That is under inertia. Visibility, it refers to the identification of a person or a property for attack. Okay, nakikita siya. Okay, so hindi mo naman mabibiktima ang isang tao kapag hindi mo siya nakikita, di ba? So, visible siya sa'yo, that's why you can be a suitable target. And then lastly, we have here, accessibility. It refers to the convenience which increases the risk of attack. So, yung place or yung location may be no suitable target. So, those are the four. Take note of the first one, value. Okay. And then we have here the inertia and then visibility and accessibility, the elements. Okay. Not the elements, but the four attributes of the suitable target. Of a suitable target. And then we have here the absence of or lack of capable guardian. So, wala yan. Kapag nawala sila, tendency magkakaroon ng opportunity yung criminals. Would be criminal to pursue with his plan. Okay, and that ends chapter 2 of our learning module. So, if you have a question, again, you can just type it on our comment section. And then that will be answered maybe in our comment section. Or if not, it will be answered in our synchronous session. So, with that, thank you for watching this video. And I hope you will be keeping those in your minds, and we'll be having the recitation about it on our synchronous sessions also. So thank you and see you next time.